everyone, and welcome. Today we're going to be talking about Exoplanets 101, and I am so happy to be your guide today for Exoplanets, because Exoplanets is actually my own subfield, and so this holds a very special place in my heart in the field of astrophysics. So today, Exoplanets 101, we're going to talk Introduction to Exoplanets, starting from the very beginning. And I think a good place to start is, what is an exoplanet? So it's actually right there in the name. Exoplanet, exo means outer, it comes from Latin, and so it just means a planet that's outside of our own system. They're also called extrasolar planets, which has a very similar etymology. Extra means outer, although this time it's Greek, that's why it's a little different. And then solar refers to our sun, which we call sol. So these are just planets that are outside of our own system. So great, that seems pretty straightforward. But this relies upon us knowing what a planet is, and that's maybe not quite as straightforward as you might think. So there actually is an official definition for what constitutes a planet, and this was voted on in 2006 by the IAU, which is the International Astronomers Union. And this is a relatively well-known decision because this definition is actually what excluded Pluto from the rank of the planets. But we're not going to get into that today. But anyway, so these are the three criteria that are necessary for a celestial body to be considered a planet. One, it must be in orbit around the sun. Two, it must have sufficient mass to overcome rigid body forces to assume hydrostatic equilibrium in a roughly spherical shape. And three, it has to clear the neighborhood of its orbit. So what do these mean? Well, one is pretty straightforward, it's in orbit around the sun. Two, what we're talking about is the shape of the body. So gravity is an inward pulling force. So a body has self-gravity that pulls it inward. But a body also has a shape, and that shape resists being pulled inward. Think of it as like crumpling up a piece of paper, right? The piece of paper isn't that resistant to being crumpled, so it's pretty easy. You don't have to exert a lot of force to crumple it into a ball. But a sheet of metal has a pretty strong rigid body force, and so it's a lot harder to crumple that up into a ball. So basically, gravity is trying to crumple up material into a ball, and if there's enough mass, it will overcome those rigid body forces, and then it becomes roughly spherical. Not perfectly spherical, because there are other effects. For example, if the body is spinning, it can become oblate and be wider at the equator, but roughly spherical. And this, for example, is why the moon, our moon, is round, but the moons of Mars are not, because they do not have sufficient mass to become these spherical bodies. And small asteroids and things, they have those very irregular shapes because they do not have this mass level. And then three, to clear the neighborhood of their own orbit just means that they are the biggest, most significant body at their orbit, and they kind of clear all the other things out. And this is actually the part of the definition that Pluto fails, because there are many other bodies around Pluto. There's a whole family of bodies called Plutinos, actually. Anyway, so okay, this seems pretty straightforward. We could just take this definition and apply it to exoplanets. But it's not actually quite that simple. So for one, the first one is that it has to be in orbit around the sun, but we already said the very definition of an exoplanet is that it's not in our own solar system. So it can't be orbiting around the sun. So you might say, okay, well, let's just replace our sun with any star, and then you can call it an exoplanet. And that works pretty well, except planets get ejected from their system, and they become free-floating planets, or rogue planets. And there are bodies that form of planetary masses that aren't ever in a system. So it's a little bit more complicated about what we might consider an exoplanet. And for the third criteria, to clear its own orbit, we don't have enough observational resolution to tell that kind of information about an exoplanet system, and so we don't know if these bodies have cleared their orbits or not. So that really just kind of leaves two, which is the mass condition, and we do use that to define exoplanets. But this sufficient mass is a lower mass limit, so it has to have enough mass to overcome the rigid body forces. But there is no upper limit in this definition for our solar system because we don't really need it. Our biggest planet is Jupiter, and that is squarely in the regime of planets. But what happens as you get bigger and bigger? Where's the dividing line between planets and then the next largest body, which we call a brown dwarf? So this is generally taken to be 13 times the mass of Jupiter, and the reason for that is because brown dwarfs are not stars. They're not massive enough to fuse hydrogen in their cores, which is what a star would do, but they are massive enough to fuse deuterium in their cores, which is a heavier isotope of hydrogen. So those are what are considered brown dwarfs. And for a star or a body that has a similar metallicity to the sun, that dividing line between being able to fuse deuterium occurs at 13 Jupiter masses. But this isn't necessarily a very satisfactory upper mass limit because it depends on the metallicity, so it depends on the composition of the body, and it doesn't take into account formation pathways. So we think that planets and brown dwarfs form in different ways. So brown dwarfs form like stars, and planets form like planets. And so it might be better to have some sort of definition that takes into account whether something formed like a brown dwarf or formed like a planet. So if you're actually interested in this, I can leave some links below for some ongoing research in this area, because this is still an active question. But in general, we'll take this to be 13 Jupiter masses. And the minimum mass limit usually tends to be about 10,000 times smaller than the mass of Jupiter. So this is a really wide range of masses that's possible for a planet. And in fact, the smallest exoplanet that we know of is PSRB 1257 plus 12b. We'll talk about exoplanet naming conventions another time. But this is a planet that was discovered around a pulsar, and you'll find out in another video why it makes sense that we'd find such a small planet around a pulsar. This is only 2% the mass of the Earth, which is about twice as massive as our moon. So this is a really tiny planet. And exoplanets, we have seen them all the way up to the mass limit and into the brown dwarf territory. So there's a huge range of masses. We don't always know the mass of exoplanets, but we'll get into that in another video. So hopefully that answers the question for you of what is an exoplanet. So the next thing you might want to know is how many exoplanets are there? Well, as of September 3rd, 2020, there are 4,276 confirmed exoplanets. And that's according to the NASA Exoplanet Archive, which is a great site that I'll link below, where you can find tons of information about all the planets and candidates that we've discovered. So that's just confirmed planets. We've also found a lot more candidates that we're still not totally convinced yet that they are planets, but many of them probably are. So here's a plot of these 4,276 exoplanets, and you can see there is a very wide variety in exoplanets. In fact, a much wider variety than we were even expecting before we started discovering exoplanets. For example, you can see this population of very massive and very close-in planets that we call hot Jupiter. And one of the very first exoplanets ever discovered was a hot Jupiter, and it was kind of controversial because people didn't think that these kind of planets could actually exist. We don't think that they can form there, and so there has to be some way that a Jupiter that formed farther out in the system got into such a small orbit. And so that was a really exciting thing that we discovered once we started discovering exoplanets. And even with this wide variety, we're still missing a ton of exoplanets because they are very hard to detect. They're very small and they are very dim compared to the stars that they orbit. And there has been a ton of effort and a lot of very smart people that have worked on different detection techniques and overcoming observational biases so that we can get a more complete picture of what exoplanets look like. So 4,000-ish exoplanets sounds like a lot, and it is, but there are hundreds of billions of stars in the Milky Way and about that many galaxies in the observable universe, so okay, 4,000 isn't really that many compared to that. So it might make more sense to ask, instead of how many have we discovered, what do we think the occurrence rate is? That is, how often do exoplanets form. There's a lot that goes into this calculation. Like I said, our observations are very difficult, and so we have to take into account all of the planets that are there, but we just can't see them yet. There's also variation with different kinds of stars, and potentially with location within the galaxy. But from what we know right now, we actually think that for a random star, the probability that it has a planet around it is approximately one. So planets, exoplanets, are super, super common. They're actually ubiquitous in the galaxy, which is really exciting because that means there's a ton more out there for us to discover and so much more to learn. And I, for one, think that it's amazing and I can't wait to see where the field goes. So hopefully now you know a little bit more about the basics of what an exoplanet is. And in future videos, we're going to talk about how we detect them and other sorts of things. So go ahead and check out the next video if you're interested. Thanks so much for tuning in, and I'll see you again next time. Bye!